are comfortable and confident, or whether you're holding on by your fingernails, or no matter where you are in between, you're welcome here. Regardless of how the world sees you, or how you see yourself, we welcome you to this service of worship. Come, let us join as a community in the worship of God. But if it is a girl, she shall live. feared God. They did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but they let the boys live. So the king of Egypt summoned those midwives and said to them, "Why have you done this and allowed the boys to live?" The midwives said to Pharaoh, "Because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them." So God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all of his people, "Every boy that is born of the Hebrews, you shall throw into the Nile, but you shall let every girl live." Now, a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore him a son. And when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch. She put the child in it and placed it among the reeds in the bank, on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to the river to bathe, while her attendants walked beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying, and she took pity on him. "This must be one of the Hebrews' children," she said. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get a nurse for you from among the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Yeah. Take the child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses, because she said, "I drew him out of the water." A word of God for the people of God.
Never knew the truth. not tell the truth. It's ugly truth, and so we don't want to look at the truth. We want to pretend that life is just ducky. And then we end up staying where we are. When you go into the Whitney, your pass is this tag that you get to wear. Everyone gets their own. And it has a picture of statues that have been created about children who lived on the Whitney when it was a working plantation. And there was also, there were interviews that were done of many of these people years later. And so excerpts from their interviews are included on the back of these. So I have three stories. I have a story of Cecile George and Frances Dopey and Julia Woodrich, all human beings who lived and worked on a plantation. I was so grateful to the docents at the Whitney who were willing to tell the truth, to talk about how one of the leaders of the slaves, leaders in terms of he was looked up to by his by the other slaves, and he was looked up to, not exactly up to, down upon, by those who ran the plantation. He did what he was asked to do. And in spite of that, because he was so well regarded by his fellow slaves, one day, in front of the rest of the slaves, the boss, the gunner, and Chapman. Life on a plantation might have been good if you were in the big house. Life on a plantation was never good if you were a slave. Never good. And we have to be willing to tell story. We can't pretend that it was anything different than that. Now, I was going to talk about this long before hateful speech was written in our church, because that's what we do at the end of August every year. We lift up Martin Luther King. He was speaking to those who gathered to hear him. And in his eloquence, he talked about knowing that he would not make it to the promised land just like Moses didn't make it to the promised land. Moses led his people for 40 years, wandering in the wilderness. Moses didn't make it to the promised land. Martin Luther King Jr. didn't make it to the promised land. But that didn't stop him from standing up. It didn't stop him from speaking up. It didn't stop him from getting other people to stand up and speak up and do the work that needs to be done. And we all are called to that work. No, we're not Martin Luther King Jr. There's one of him. But we are who we are. Each of us is called to stand up in our own way. As Rabbi Max said at the beginning of the service, the you is you, Jimmy. The you is you, Warren. The you is you, Greg. The you is you, and you, and you. Each one of us is you. Each of us. And it doesn't work for us to compare ourselves to person sitting next to us. Cleo's gifts are different than yours, aren't they, Lauren? And Lauren's gifts are different than yours, aren't they, Cleo? They're his gifts, they're her gifts. Each of us has our own gifts, and we use those gifts. And maybe we're scared when we're asked
our friends from us.
And others of us said, I am so grateful to live in a time and place where we don't have to be quiet, where we don't have to pretend it didn't happen, where we don't have to diminish the impact. The reality is that our building itself suffered no permanent damage. The words were written on removable signs, which were removed immediately and handed to the police. But I can tell you, hearts aren't so easily erased. This is a place, this particular place, this Pilgrim Congregational Church, United Church of Christ, is a safe place for everyone. And yet, it became a place violated. We don't know who. We don't know if this was someone who's on a tear to do all this stuff in many places. The police had no other reports. We don't know if it was a one-off. We don't know if this was someone who was hurting and that was his outlet or her outlet. We don't know. What we do know is that there are hearts that are broken in this place and in this community and around the country and the world. When I posted to Facebook, my nieces and my granddaughter posted it, and so did a bunch of other people, posted it to many people around the world, and people are responding, oh no. And they said wonderful things about this church, even if they had never been here, that this church they knew to be a place that cares, a place that stands up, a place that speaks up, a place that will never be. But it doesn't mean we have to respond. We are called to respond in love when we have that opportunity. Many of you were here yesterday when the community gathered for a prayer vigil. I'm not sure no one counted the room, but I'm guessing it was 200, 250 people who came here because they wanted to stand with Pilgrim Church. It was an amazing experience to have so many people stand with us. And this morning, whoa, y'all done an amazing thing to my heart. It's that kind of thing that helps us heal. I don't know how many times I have stood here in the front of the church and talked about how no, we can't fix it, that this has happened. No, we can't fix it, that has happened. But what we can do is we can stand up with each other. And in some cases, we can sit down with each other. We can sit with each other and hold hands and say, we are with you. That's what we can do. And I saw the power of that healing yesterday and today and throughout the week as I've seen what's come down on social media. What a blessing to live in this time when we are so challenged and so supported. What a blessing. Now listen. We are called to use our gifts, whatever they are, to make a difference in this world. We are called to help realize God's realm here and now, not tomorrow, not the day after, this day. We are called to love each other. That should be easy. I got it, baby. This amazing story was given to us this day, this story of the women around the baby Moses finding a way to preserve a life. This story was given to us this day to remind us that no matter what, we are called to lift of hope, to be faithful people, to love our God